What is the best thing that you have ever done to demonstrate your love to them? What action is it that you have taken to show someone that you love them? What action is it that you have taken to show you love somebody else, to let them know that you care? A lot of times it's much easier to say that we love someone than it is to actually demonstrate it or do something about it. But the greatest demonstration of love in the history of the world is when Jesus Christ died on the cross. It is why he came into this world, so that he could pay the price for our sins. It is why God sent him into the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. It is love that drove Christ to the cross. We have been looking at the seven last words of Jesus as he hung on the cross. And the ones that we're going to look at this morning come from John chapter 9. And after we look at these, we'll go to another passage. But we want to start with John chapter 9, beginning in John chapter 19, beginning in verse 26. It says, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to his disciples, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. Now, when we look at that passage, one of the things I want to quickly note is, I was sharing with them earlier, if I ever walked up to my mom and said, "Woman," and followed it with anything, my dad would have hit me when I was a kid as a lack of disrespect. We need to understand that the word being said here is not taken culturally and contextually that way. It really is a term of endearment. And so when Jesus says woman, it's a positive sign. So don't read 21st century United States into that. It really is. Jesus is being respectful to his mother when he says this. So I want us to think about also what's going on when Jesus says this. About 12 hours earlier, less than 12 hours earlier, he was betrayed by one of his closest disciples, one of the 12 that had been within him. He had been in the garden. As he was in the garden, and I read about it again this week in the Gospel of Mark, where it talks about this idea that he was just pained almost to the point of death. And as he prayed in the garden for an hour multiple times, the disciples fell asleep. They couldn't stay with him. So he's facing the anguish of what he's about to do. That he's about to receive the cup of wrath from God. That he is about to take on the sins of the world. That he is about to be physically put to death. As Jesus is hanging on the cross, he has a crown of thorns that would have led to streams of blood down his face and head. He has been scourged, which means they took a whip that had the bones and metal and rock on the end of it to help rip out his flesh. He's been spat on. He's been beaten in the face. He's been mocked. Even as he hangs on the cross, they keep mocking him. "If you're the Messiah, get yourself down." As he's being crucified, his hands nailed to a cross, he's beginning to suffocate in his weakened state. The oxygen deprived from his body would make his lungs hurt, and the piercing that would go into that. And so he would try to push himself up his back against the rugged cross where he's been beaten. And as he pushes himself up, he's pushing up against a nail that's been put into his feet, creating even more excruciating pain, but willing to push up just to have the chance to breathe. And in the middle of that physical anguish, he also, him who knew no sin that became sin for us, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He is taking on our sins so that we can be redeemed, so that we can be saved, so that through the shedding of his blood, our sins can be forgiven. All of that's going on. He's about to be separated from the Father. We'll look at sometime later this idea of my Father, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Because he's taken on our sins. And in the middle of all of that physical pain, the spiritual torment, the emotional struggle that he has as a man because he's fully human, and praying as drops of blood to avoid what he's in the middle of, he looks down and he sees his mother, and his heart is for her to be taken care of. He says, "Woman, this is your son." Then he looks at John and says, "This is your mother." I read a lot of interesting interpretations of that passage this week. But there was one thing that they all had in common. And that is that it was Jesus' love in the middle of all that he was going through that compelled him to take care of his mother. Jesus was the oldest child. His dad, Joseph, would have died, and therefore he would have been responsible for his mother, and now he's passing that along. It's interesting that he isn't passing that along to one of his physical brothers, one of his half-brothers, but that's probably because, it's speculated, because he wanted to pass his mom's responsibility on to someone that believed in him already. And we know that Jesus' brothers didn't believe in who he was until after his resurrection. And James, one of his half-brothers, would end up being the first pastor, the first leader of the church in Jerusalem. But they weren't at that point yet. And so Jesus gave John the responsibility of taking care of his mother. And so as we think about that, I want us to think about this idea of what is love. We know that in the New Testament, there's really three different kinds of love. There's the phileo, which is more like a brotherly love. There's eros, which is more of a physical love. And then there's agape, which is a self-sacrificing, giving yourself of love. And that's the kind of love we're talking about in the passage that we're going to look at in just a moment. But it's this love that we're supposed to say. The other thing I want to say before we read our passage, a couple more things. Before we look at we're going to look at 1 John chapter 4 if you want to turn there in your Bibles. But before we actually read it, as we talk about this idea of love, we understand that we already know from Deuteronomy chapter 6, and Jesus quotes this during his life, that there is no greater love than this, than a man, or the greatest commandment of all is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and strength. And the second command is this: love your neighbor as yourself. And so as we talk about love this morning, we never want to lose that idea that there's a love of God, but also there's the love of our neighbors. And when somebody asked who is your neighbor, he gave the story of the Good Samaritan. It wasn't the priest that passed by, it wasn't the Levite that passed by, it was the hated Samaritan that was willing to demonstrate his care for a man that had fallen among thieves, that showed what a neighbor really does. And so all of that's backdrop to understand when we talk about love, that's included. But today we're going to talk about the love of God within the body of Christ. See, 1 John basically provides a test for us to understand if we're genuinely saved. People, am I genuinely saved? And we ask that question. Well, John gives us three tests in 1 John. He starts with this idea of we have to believe in the right Jesus. That's what he starts with. Many people, because of Greek philosophy, had decided that anything physical is bad, anything spiritual is good. Therefore, Jesus could not have come in the flesh. He could not have been man because the flesh is bad, and a God would never put himself in a position to be flesh. And John's like, no, we've touched him. We know who he is. And so we have to know who Jesus is. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus has always existed. He is equal with God. He has a different role, but he is equal to the Father in substance. They are the same substance, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So Jesus is fully God, and he is fully man. He walked a perfect life so that he could be the sacrifice for our sins, because the wages of sin is death. And so because somebody had to die when we commit a sin, Jesus, because of his love, died on the cross for us. And so we understand that Jesus paid that price for us. He paid that and walked this earth. He physically rose from the dead. That's why he eats with his disciples. as we know that it was a physical resurrection. So that's the first test. We have to have the right Jesus, not the Mormon Jesus that says what Jesus was, we are, what Jesus is, we will be. Basically saying Jesus was a man, that's what we are. Jesus is a God, that's what we will be. That's the wrong Jesus. We're never going to be a God. Jehovah's Witness equate often Jesus with the archangel Michael. No, Jesus wasn't an angel. Jesus is God. And we have to have the right view of Jesus for salvation. Another test that 1 John gives early in the past, early in the book, and then also throughout, is this idea that we are going to be holy. That we are going to walk a life of holiness. That we're going to be pure. Now, 1 John reminds us, even in the first chapter, that God's faithful and just to forgive our sins, anticipation that we're going to sin. He also says, by the way, if any of you say you're not a sinner, you're a liar and God has nothing to do with you. So we understand that even though we're going to live a whole, we're to live a holy life, that we're not going to be perfect with this side of heaven. And no matter how pure we walk, there are going to be times that we sin. If you remember, the sin offering in the Old Testament was for unknown sin. So even when we think we're walking, if we're free from all known sin, there are sins in our life that we're not aware of, that we're offending a holy God with. So that's the second test. The third test is this, that you have the love for the brothers, that you love other believers. And that's really at the heart of what it's going to talk about. So understanding, we understand love is action-oriented. We understand that we love the Lord our God with all our heart, our mind, our soul, and our strength. We understand that we love our neighbors, ourselves, those that are outside the church. But we also understand that there is a special bond that does exist inside the church. So John, God's word says in 1 John chapter 4, beginning in verse 7, dear friends, let us love one another, because love is from God. And everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent His one and only Son in the world so that we might live through Him. Love consists in this: not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us in this way, we also must love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God remains in us, and His love is perfected in us. Why don't you unite our hearts in prayer? Dear God, we come before you in this moment to praise you again as our Almighty God, to praise you for your beauty and your majesty, your power, your might, thanking you for these words penned by John that were inspired by your Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for the demonstration of love that you had for your mother that we've read about. And now as we dive deeper into 1 John, Lord, I pray that your Spirit will be very real, that you will convict us and draw us closer to you, that we indeed can reflect you in a greater way in this world. It's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Theme of our passage, true love is demonstrated through actions that reflect Christ in our life. True love is reflected by actions, not just what we say, but what we do, that reflect Christ in our life. True love comes from Christ. Now, we're going to look at some considerations about love. First of all, we're going to see and reflect on the definition of love. The definition of love. Dear friends, the term of endearment that John uses consistently throughout this letter. Let us love one another. He's writing to believers. Really giving a command here. Let us love one another. It's an encouragement. It's an exhortation. Let us love one another, because love is from God. Our love is generated from God. Our love of other believers is generated from God and not of ourselves. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. If we genuinely love, it is born of God and it comes from knowing God. That tells us that the world, the lost world, is incapable of genuine, true love. Because love is only known through God. It is why, often in our culture, movies, television, books, just the way people live in pop culture, music, whatever it is, have a distorted view of love. Often the world's view of love has much to do with lust, and maybe even more to do with selfishness. Because we look at what makes us happy instead of focusing on the love that God shows that is not self-serving, but of giving to others. And so we can never look at the world for a definition of love, because the world cannot know love, because love itself comes from God. Let us love one another, because love is from God, and everyone who loves God has been born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Now, when I was little, one of the first memory verses I learned was God is love, because they only got us to memorize the last three words of the verse. It was one of the first verses I remember learning, God is love. That's the definition of love. God is love. God doesn't set the example of love. God isn't a concept of love. God Himself is love. It is at the very core of who God is. And so true love will always be a reflection of God, because God is love. And so if I am going to love, I have to understand that my definition of love has to be incorporated into who God is. Now, we talked about this idea that our world distorts the view of love. How is it that a loving God can cause someone to go to hell? How is it that a loving God can allow for tragedy? Can allow for a stillborn baby? How is it that a loving God can allow cancer to exist? Now, I'll be honest. Those, as a believer, when we try to explain God to someone, is apologetically, that's one of the toughest questions we have to deal with. In fact, I would argue it's probably the hardest question that we have to deal with when we're trying to talk about God to someone that doesn't know Him. Because the truth of the matter is, cancer, disaster, death, all of those are a result of man's choice to disobey God and bring sin into His creation. God's perfect world, when we see the perfect demonstration of love fully realized, there will be no death, there will be no pain, because God is love. It's who He is. Now, I just had an opportunity over the last 11 weeks or so to teach a class on the Gospel of John. And I learned some things about John that I never really realized before about how the Gospel's structured. Fascinating, fascinating Gospel. But one of the things that you run into is the first 12 chapters of John is basically about Jesus trying to reach out to the Israelites, to the Jews of that era. There's a lot of confrontation, particularly set up in chapter 5 at the temple. But there's this continual struggle of Jesus as He goes into Jerusalem to celebrate the festivals, that He's constantly at odds. But He's always trying to say, look, I am the good shepherd. I am the light. And He's constantly sharing with them who He is. And what we see, just as in John's prologue, that the light was rejected. Jesus was the light, and that light was the life of men, and the darkness did not receive Him. And so the world continued to, the Jews continued to reject Jesus. And so for 12 chapters, that's pretty much what the gospel's about. There's a little bit of transition in 11 and 12, but the first 12 chapters, primarily that's what you have, is Jesus trying to reach out to the Jewish community and let them know he's the Messiah they've been looking for. And then we get to 13. And when we get to chapter 13, it is the beginning of Jesus preparing his messianic community, the community that is going to follow the Messiah. And so from 13 through the end of the end of the book, we see Jesus talking with and developing his disciples. We see the crucifixion, the resurrection, and then we see the reestablishment of Peter, and we see some post-resurrection appearances. And all of that is to prepare those that are left to go into the world. So John, through the power of the Holy Spirit, inspired of the Holy Spirit, is writing out. And John tells you at the end of his gospel, he goes, look, if I wrote down everything that Jesus did, there's probably not enough books in the world. He tells us the theme of his book is that this is written so that you might know God, may know the Messiah, know Jesus, and know him and receive eternal life. So he's picking specific stories to demonstrate what it is to be with Christ. And so when he starts out with this idea of how is it that Jesus is going to prepare his messianic community, the story we get is Jesus washing the disciples' feet that night that he's going to be betrayed. Now, a lot of times we like to bang on the disciples and say, you know, one of them should have done it. They clearly were not the master, but they were all too egotistical. And there's some truth to that. We know that even that night they were fighting over who was the greatest. But realistically, in their culture, there was never an expectation that a disciple would be the one that washed the feet of the other disciples and the rabbi, the teacher, the leader. And so they really weren't going against social norms at the time. But after dinner, we know that Jesus went over, took off his outer garment, put on a towel, got water, started to wash their feet. Where Jesus started teaching the followers of Christ what he showed first was an absolute service mentality to other people. That we are not here for our glorification, that we're not here to be lifted up. We are to serve other believers. Jesus told the disciples, you call me rabbi, teacher. You're right, that's who I am. I'm your rabbi. I'm your instructor. But now this thing that I've done, you go and do also. At the heart of love is the willingness to serve others, the willingness to serve someone else, to make it not about ourselves, but to give beyond what's expected to demonstrate God's love to other believers and within the body. That same night, Jesus is talking to the disciples, and we get to John chapter 15, and he says this, as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have spoken these things to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. This is my command. Love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, than someone would lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Jesus isn't saying, if you do what I command you to earn your salvation. What he's saying is that if you are my friends, you will love other believers. You will love the body. You will demonstrate that love by your actions. This is the command. Love one another. And so this definition of love, we see that it means that we will sacrifice ourselves for those in the body of Christ. those that are other believers. We will put their needs above our own. The definition of love, the personification of love, the personification of love. Verse 9. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent His one and only Son into the world so that we might live through Him. God's love was revealed among us. How do we know about God's love? It's because this, because God sent His Son. And again, John in his gospel, God so loved the world that He sent His one and only, that His only one and only Son, His only begotten Son. It's the same word in this verse, His one and only Son into the world so that we might live through Christ. That's what love looks like. Sending your child into the world to be punished and to die for someone else. As a parent, can you imagine sending your son out to intentionally die for those that are mocking him and beating him and spitting on him? That's the love. That's the personification of the love that we're to have. As a parent, I can't imagine doing that with one of my children. Now, I would never ask a child that because they think they're being tortured all the time when they get disciplined. But make no mistake, God's love is personified in the fact that He sent Jesus to die for our sins, and that Jesus came and died for our sins, His one and only Son. Love consists in this: not that we love God, but that He loved us. It goes back to this concept that I can't know God, I can't know love without knowing God. See, Brian read last night at our upward banquet, you know, there's no one righteous, no, not one. Romans quoting Paul, quoting from the Old Testament. There's also this idea that I can't love until the love of God is in me. Until that love that's completely sacrificial in putting myself dead last has come upon me. Not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Big word, propitiation. It means to appease the wrath of God. The wages of sin is death. As soon as we sin, we deserve the full wrath of God to be poured out on us. Go read in Revelation what the wrath of God looks like. God's full fury and anger poured out on us. Jesus as the propitiation means that He took that wrath for us. So see, when Jesus is on the cross, it's not all the physical things that we talked about earlier. It's really not just that He's separated from God for the first time through all eternity. It's that God's cup of wrath, is just poured out on Him completely for all the sins committed in the world. And being willing to take that is what the picture of love is. That's the personification of love. That Jesus Christ took that for us. One of the interesting stories in Scripture is that of Paul. Paul gets saved on the road to Damascus. He sees Jesus. Paul, why are you persecuting me? And if you remember, Paul was blind. And so God wanted to send Ananias over to Paul's house to lift the scales off his eyes. And Ananias goes, hey, God, this is the dude that's been wanting to kill everybody. Are you sure you want me to go over there? God says, yeah, that's where I want you to go. So Ananias goes. Paul eventually goes to Jerusalem. The Jerusalem church knows what? It's where Paul came from. That's where he received his orders to go out and persecute Christians. They didn't want him there. He's from outside the church. He's been persecuting us. Why in the world are we going to let Saul at the time come and be with us? And there was one guy mentioned specifically in Scripture that stood up for him. A guy named Barnabas. His name means son of encouragement. And Barnabas stood there and said, and helped to bring Paul into acceptance within the church. Not fearing for his life, but willing to serve someone else, willing to help someone else. It's who Barnabas was. Sold land, gave it to everyone, or gave it to the church to give to those that are poor. When John Mark ran off on a mission trip and Paul didn't want to take him on the second mission trip, Barnabas goes, I'll go with him. And they split up and Paul took Silas. Barnabas, the son of encouragement, willing to demonstrate love and compassion to another believer in Christ as part of the church. If we go just a few verses earlier than our passage in 1 John chapter 3, beginning verse 16, it says this: this is how we have come to know love. He laid his life down for us. We should also lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has the world's good and sees his brother in need but closes his eyes to his need, how can God's love reside in him? Little children, we must not love with word or speech, but with truth and action. Love comes from truth and action. The definition of love, the personification of love. Finally, we see the instruction of love. The instruction of love. Verse 11, again, dear friends, if God loved us in this way, that he sent his son to be the propitiation, that Jesus came and was the propitiation, if God loved us in this way, we also must love one another. We must also love one another. No one's ever seen God. If we love one another, God remains in us and his love is perfected in us. I think that's a weird sentence. It's just interesting that it just stands out kind of weird with the way that the rest of the paragraph flows. But I think it makes an extremely important point. No one's ever seen God. We've been talking about loving each other and all that. We talked about Jesus, he's propitiation. And then John writes, no one's ever seen God. Why does he write that? But, I think you could almost put a but in there. If we love one another, God remains in us and his love is perfected in us. It's completed in us. See, the world can't see God. What the world can see is the completed love of God in his body, the church. Nobody can see God, but your love of action can be completed so that people see God. And that's really when you go back again to chapter 13, and we talked about the washing the feet and all that. And by the way, when he washed the feet, Judas, who was going to betray him, was still there. So sometimes we're going to get abused. It's okay. We're to serve. But in that same chapter, John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, after washing their feet, Jesus said this, a new command I give you. Remember, we know the greatest commands. Love the Lord your God. Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus says, now a new command I give you. Love one another. In the way that I love you, love one another. By this love, all men will know that you are my disciples, that you love one another. We're commanded to love. Jesus modeled love for us. And then it says, that's how people are going to know you're really the church. That's how people are going to know you're really my disciples, that you complete and are perfected in the love of God. I don't think there's any doubt. We talked before, the hardest thing in apologetics, as trying to talk to somebody that's not part of the church, you're trying to explain to them about God, is evil. That's the hardest apologetic. I don't know if anybody that doesn't argue with that. Second is what we label a lot of times as hypocrisy in the church. starts out broad. Why are there so many denominations? Why is there so much variety even within Southern Baptists? Why are there three Southern Baptist churches within 2.5 miles of where we're standing? Why is there so much? And then it gets even to each individual church. Why are there feuds? If church is so good, why do people talk negative about it? Our love's not perfected and completed. God's love is not demonstrated until we love one another. When there's hostile feelings, God's love isn't being perfected and it can't be seen by the world. One of the reasons why people don't flock to the church is the perception of the church is a place where you go to be loved. Ask an unbeliever sometime, just ask them, give me 5 definitions of what you think of when you think of the church. And if you find someone that in their first 5 descriptions says the church is a place to be loved, I'll be shocked. And I'll be honest with you. Ask a believer that, and if they haven't heard the sermon this morning, I'd be surprised if they said that was 1 of the 5. Because we as a church don't always love. I want to ask you a question. We got a lot of oak showing in here. Who's somebody that you know is missing that hasn't been here for a while? Now don't tell me they might come to the early service. Who's somebody you hadn't seen in Sunday school? Who's somebody that you know hadn't come to church for a month? Not because of illness, but just regularly aren't coming. What have you done to reach out to demonstrate your love for them and that you care that they're not here? We used to have active care groups, from what I understand, in this church, where people made sure if somebody missed a week or two, we were in contact with them. Are we doing that now? I just want to challenge you this week. Think of someone that's not currently here. Maybe they grew up in this church and haven't been back for 20 years. Maybe it's just been a few weeks. Who is it that God's put on your heart that you know this week you need to reach out and demonstrate your love to? And I believe God wants us to do that. I had somebody come up to me after the first service this morning and said, you know, I'm glad you said that. He goes, God put somebody's name on my heart this morning when I woke up. He goes, now I'm going to make sure I contact them. It's not the preacher's job to contact everybody. We've made it that in American churches. But the body is to build the body. I won't be like Randy. Y'all might get mad at me for saying that. And y'all might think that's me kicking responsibility. It's not. Go back and look at pastoral responsibility in the Bible. Is to prepare people to do the work of the ministry. It's each member's responsibility to demonstrate the love of God and to make sure that people care. Are we willing to reach out to people even when it hurts ourselves, even when it's difficult, and demonstrate that God loves us, loves the believers? As Jesus came, tells us in the introduction of John, the Word became flesh and took up residence among us. That took residence, a lot of times we hear dwelt among us. Literally what the word there is tabernacled among us. If you remember the tabernacle, that basically means tent from the Old Testament. We go back to the children of Israel, the tabernacle was in the middle when they moved. 3 tribes. East, west, north, south, we're always surrounded. But in the middle, it's the tabernacle that represented the presence of God. And when they traveled, that's how they traveled, with the presence of God right in the center. When John writes this, the word he literally uses, Jesus dwelt, tabernacled, took up residence with us. We observed his glory. The glory is the one and only Son from God and full of grace and truth. Skip down to verse 18. No one has ever seen God. The one and only Son, the one who is at God's side, he has revealed him. Jesus has revealed the love of God. Jesus has commanded us to demonstrate the love of God to believers. A new command I give you, love one another. The way that I have loved you, love one another. By this love, all men will know that you are my disciples, that you love one another. What is it that we're doing to demonstrate the love of God? It's been interesting as I thought about the words of Christ that we've looked at so far in these 3 weeks. Starts out with forgiveness. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. We've all been there. If we're a believer, we've been there where we needed the forgiveness of God. Last week, today you'll be with me in paradise, a picture of heaven, that we're one day going to be in heaven. We need forgiveness. We're going to heaven. But we're not there yet. You know what we do in the meantime? Love one another. That God's love may be completed. No one's ever seen God, but they can see our love. His love can be seen through us. The definition of love, God is love. The personification of love, Jesus is our propitiation, that we may be redeemed. Now, it may be this morning that you've never experienced the love of God. And this may be the day that you realize you've never completely surrendered to God, that the love of God's not in you. And it may be this morning that you need to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And we'll have a chance, an invitation to him, that maybe you need to come up and talk to me about that. But Jesus paid the price as the propitiation and the instruction of love. No one's ever seen God. But his love is perfected, it's completed in us. In the love that we show to each other. Let's unite our hearts in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you in this moment to praise you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. To praise you because you are love. We thank you that you sent your Son to be the propitiation for our sins, that he appeased your wrath that each of us deserve. Lord, I pray if there's someone here this morning that's never received that love and is not part of your family, that your Holy Spirit will come on them in such a way that they will be able to not be able to resist you. And that they will receive the salvation that you offer freely, monetarily, but at the cost of a life surrendered to you. That we will give up things of this world to serve you. But God, I pray for our believers, myself as a believer, that we will love others within the body. Lord, we know we need to love you. We know we want to love those outside the body. And we've talked about evangelism before, but this morning, God, reveal to us through the power of your Holy Spirit how we can become a church that when someone says Lebanon Baptist Church, that we have become synonymous with the love of God. God, I pray that you'll give us a specific name, maybe even more than one name, that we haven't seen in Sunday school, at church. Maybe it's somebody we see every day, but we never take the time to make sure they know how much we love them. God, let us indeed, as we hear those words and we get ready to sing them,
let us surrender all. Let us surrender our pride, our ego, and all that we are for the glory of you, that your love will be completed in us, perfected in us, as you desire. To the precious name of Jesus Christ, we pray.